हेलो एवरीवन, माय सेल्फ स्वाति जयवंत कोकाटे फ्रॉम नागेश करजगी ऑर्किड स्कूल. टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू टीच यू हिस्ट्री लेसन नंबर 2, दैट इज न्यू किंग्स एंड किंगडम्स. सो फ्रॉम दिस लेसन्स नेम ओनली यू विल अंडरस्टैंड चिल्ड्रन दैट हाउ दिस न्यू किंग्स और किंगडम्स केम इनटू एग्जिस्टेंस, हाउ दिस किंग्स और दिस डायनेस्टीज एमर्ज्ड. सो वी आर गोइंग टू सी दैट many new dynasties, okay, many new kingdoms, kings, they emerged after 7th century, that is from 7th to 12th century. In the map 1, okay, in this map 1, you can see that here many subcontinents are there. What are the subcontinents? They are the neighboring countries, might be Nepal, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, okay, Bengal, all these are the subcontinents of here, and how these dynasties were going on or they were emerging and how they grew. Then we are going to see that the emergence of new dynasties, okay. Here by the 7th century there were big landlords or warrior chiefs. Now who are big landlords? Landlords means those who are having lands and more money. And who were warrior chiefs? Warrior chiefs were the person, okay, who were having army force for fighting or for soldiers, and they used to help the king whenever he was in need. So this region of the subcontinents means these existing kings often acknowledged them, means whenever the king was in need, he used to ask for these subordinates or samantas. Here this word is very important, children. Who are samantas? Because nowadays we don't use this word. That was used for subordinates of the king, that is samantas. Means what the samantas were, means what they used to do. These persons were having land, okay, they were having some good, what we call warrior chiefs, they were having soldiers, and they used to help the king. So they were, when the king was in need, they used to help them, and what they were expected, they should bring gifts for their kings or overlords. Overlords means under whom these people were, these samantas were working. Then as samantas gained power, okay, and also they used to be present at their courts when, and also provide them with military support whenever the king was in need, whenever the king was going for a fight with other king and he wanted. So these samantas used to help them. As samantas gained power, okay, then these samantas, they worked under the king. But when they gained power, okay, they gained more wealth, these samantas were given lands by the king, okay, also some good, whenever this king used to win the battle, he came back, he used to give these samantas good money, good wealth, land, these all things. Then automatically these samantas, they became more powerful and also wealthy. Then they declared, so what happened? Now they were not ready to work under this king. So they declared themselves to be Mahasamanta or Mahamandaleshwara. What is this, the meaning of it? That is the great lord of a circle or that region, and so on. So here we can see that when samantas, who are samantas? They are the subordinates of the king. They used to help the king, and when, because of that help, the king used to give them wealth, okay, and already these samantas had wealth, and again when they got more wealth and they became more powerful, so they did not wish to work under that king. So they declared themselves that now we are not ready to work under that king, we are the Mahasamantas now, Mahamandaleshwara, and the great lord of circle of that region, and so on. So they told that and declared that we are going to be the Mahasamantas of that region, and sometimes they asserted their independence from their overlords. So like this, overlords means the king or the whoever person was there under whom they were working, they declared themselves as independent and they wanted their own rule. Fine. Then of this one such instance or one such example, we can see here that this Rashtrakutas in the Deccan, okay, Rashtrakutas, all these are the dynasties, okay. Whenever you will read the lesson or these will, you will listen often and often these all words, Mahasamantas, Samantas, Rashtrakutas, and all these words you will understand and remember one by one. So initially they were the subordinates, okay, of the Chalukyas of Karnataka. They were working under the Chalukyas of Karnataka. They were subordinates. Who? These Rashtrakutas. Then in the mid 8th century, what happened? This Danti Durga, a Rashtrakuta chief, okay, this Danti Durga was a Rashtrakuta chief, overthrew his Chalukya, okay, and overlord and performed a ritual called Hiranyagarbha. Now this is little new for you. What is Hiranyagarbha? See children, it means that golden womb, okay. In Hindi, you can say that a mother's kok, jo kehte hai, okay. Then what it means, what happened? Now all were not having, all were not soldiers, okay. Some were Brahmins or other religions. So they were not like Kshatriyas, they did not have soldiers or they did not use to give a fight to other kings or other states and all. So what happened here? What is meant by Hiranyagarbha? Means that if you are not a Kshatriya by birth, okay, then this a ritual was formed. What is ritual? A ritual is a religious ceremony of a action performed according to the prescribed order by the Brahmins. So they used to do, we can call some puja or something, and make that person a Kshatriya, even if he is not one by birth. If that person is not a Kshatriya by birth, he was given, or he was by doing a literally Hiranyagarbha, he was made or he was given as a, treated as a Kshatriya afterwards. So what is this? Did you understand what is Hiranyagarbha? It is a ritual performed by the Brahmins, and with this, with the help of it, one used to, if he is, the person is not a Kshatriya by birth, then he can be afterwards declared or can be considered as a Kshatriya, okay. Means he can again have all the rights to fight against and also increase his power and wealth. So in other cases, men from enterprising families, okay, then again who are having this wealth or who are given this powers? The men from enterprising families use their military skills to carve out kingdoms. So what was this? In other cases, the person who were from the already the that families, they use their military skills, okay, to carve their kingdoms. Now here for example, we can see this, the Kadamba Mayureshwaram, okay, and the Gurjara Pratihara Harichandra were the Brahmins who gave up their traditional professions. Now see here, these were the Brahmins, okay, but their traditional professions they gave up, means they left it and they took the arms, successfully establishing kingdoms in Karnataka and Rajasthan respectively. Means these people, what they did, they were the Brahmanas and they were never, they never used to fight in the battles, but when this ritual was formed, that is Hiranyagarbha, okay, this was performed, this ritual was performed, and they were from the enterprising, means from families they were Brahmins, but after that when this ritual was formed, these traditional professions, they took arms, means they started and for fighting in the battles and they established their new kingdoms in Karnataka and Rajasthan respectively. So what is admin, how is the administration in these kingdoms? The subtopic we are going to see. Okay, fine. Administration should be there in the kingdom for this smooth running. So how this administration took place, whether the king himself had too much money from the starting? No, he requires money, isn't it, for the smooth functioning of the full empire. He requires money. How it will run, how the things will go on, even the soldiers who are there, he has to see, look after them also. He has to provide food, whatever requirements are there to the soldiers and also to the families. So how these kings got money or wealth, how the money was collected? So administration in the kingdoms we will see here. Many of these new kings adopted high sounding titles. So when these kings became powerful, they declared themselves or they adopted the high sounding titles such as Mahamandaleshwara or Maharaja Adhiraja and Tribhuvan Chakravarti, means Rajaon ke Raja. Maharaja Adhiraja means they declared themselves Rajaon ke bhi hum Raja hai, aur Tribhuvan Chakravarti means they are the king or they are the lord of three worlds, that is what we call in Hindi Patal, Akash or Dharti. In tino ke bhi wo sab lord hai. But even though they were the things, they called themselves, they need power from their samantas. See, alone they can't do anything. Even they, for the battles also, they required the soldiers, isn't it? So, and for fighting or in the battles, they need these soldiers and they have to pay for these soldiers, isn't it? Or the other administration people, administrative people in his court. So they often shared power with their samantas as well as with associates of peasants, traders and brahmanas. Okay, these all requirements, they were with associations of these people, peasants, those who were working in farms, traders are the businessmen, and the brahmanas who were the teachers or who were used to give suggestions and all, or read the things, because they were the learned persons in those days. Others were not knowing much about reading and writing. So these kings, even though they were declared themselves as Maharaja Adhiraja or something like that, they were always in need of these people. So we are going to see what was the administration, how this administration was going on. So in each state, each of these state, resources were obtained from the producers. Okay, then how these resources in this state, from the producers, that is peasants, cattle keepers, artisans, who were often persuaded or compelled to surrender part of their produce. See, nowadays also, children, you must have listened what are taxes. Okay, whenever you buy some product, if it is of 10 rupees, you can see that the price is written 10 rupees, but the actually producing cost might be only 5 rupees. But you can see that here many taxes are written in the bracket on that box. So you can see that these are the taxes from at those days also, they were contributing the taxes in the same way. So how were they produce, these producers? Okay, if the producer was producing something, he has to give the share of it, the peasants, okay, the cattle keepers, whatever they were producing or whatever the things, whatever income he was getting, artisans, whatever things he was producing, a part of it was compulsorily given to these kings. Sometimes these were claimed as rent, okay, due to the lord who asserted them the own land. This land, okay, they thought that the land is given, it is of that king, but and they are using it. So the rent was also given to them. revenue was also collected from the traders. So, how this revenue was collected? The traders, those who were in profit or those who were trading there, they had to give revenue to this. And like this, the king's administration means there were people who collected all this money. So, here in this inscription of Cholas, you can see that 400 taxes were there of different type. Then most frequently, but in this most frequently mentioned tax is vetti, that is not taken in cash. Okay, when you think of something that is tax, the thing comes in your mind is only cash. But here you can see that what is vetti, it is not taken in cash. Then how it is taken? It is taken in the form of forced labor, okay, or land revenue. Means what? Here you have to give some service, fine, and also some land revenue. There were also taxes on thatching the houses, the use of ladder to climb the palm trees, assess on succession of to family property, etc. So what is here cess? Cess means also a tax. Okay, this word can be used as a tax. So nowadays also think of the such taxes collected today. Do you know which taxes are collected? Just you can discuss with your parents. Now here these resources were, then how these resources, okay, were used? These resources were used to finance the king's establishment as well as for the construction of temples and forts. Then these money, why, how, for what purpose this money was collected from the people and how it was used, how it was administered? These resources were used to finance the king's establishment. Okay, whatever requirements, establishment requirements are there, it was used, as well as for the constructions of temples and forts. There were also used to fight wars. I told it first only that they were also used to fight wars with other kings, and which were in turn expected to lead to the acquisition of wealth in the form of plunder and access to the land as well as to the trade routes. Means here, if the trade routes, if the traders are passing by from that route, even they had to give the, in the form of taxes. Okay, if they were using that way or that path from that particular area, they had to give the taxes to that particular king. Then what was this? The functionaries from collecting revenue were generally recruited from influential families. So all were not having the right to collect the tax or revenue, children. These functions for collecting tax or revenue were generally recruited from the influential families. Okay, means from first who is collecting that, the same person has to, or the children of that things, they have to collect those taxes, and the position were given often hereditary. As I told you, son, then father or grandfather, like this, it was hereditary. This was true about the army as well. Same here, those who were collecting tax, same was with the army. The person whose father, forefathers, grandparents were in army, they were only allowed to be in the part. In many cases, close relatives of that king held these positions. So here also we can see that if the person of, if the people are the close relatives of the king, they hold this position of collecting taxes, revenues and all these things. Now to the subtopic we are going, prashastis and land grants. Prashastis, do you remember, children? We have gone through with this word in the first lesson. What is prashastis? Prashastis contains details that may be not literally true. What are prashastis? They are the inscriptions, or they are a plate like thing on which the king tells, and the Brahmins or the told person writes whatever the king tells to him to carve on it. So many times the king may tell that whatever he wants, which is not true, in to be written on that. So Prashastis contain details that might be, so here it is told that it might be not literally true, but they tell us how rulers wanted to depict themselves, like means how they rulers, they wanted to tell as how they were, as valiant victorious warriors, for example. Okay, they wanted to tell about themselves. These were composed by learned Brahmins who occasionally helped in the administration. So how these Brahmins helped? They used to write about the things of administration, which things were conquered by that particular king. See, some of the, like this, one of the, this we can see here, Prashastis, how it is written of Nagbhatta. Many rulers describe their achievements in Prashastis. You have read in Gupta ruler Samudragupta last year. One such Prashasti was written in Sanskrit and found in Gwalior, Madhya Pradesh. Described the exploits of Nagbhatta, a Pratihara king. See, all these types, it was written in Sanskrit, but here it is translated in English. The kings of Andhra, Sindh, Vidarbha, Orissa fell before him even as he was a prince. See how it was written by those Brahmins. He won a victory over Chakrayuddha, the ruler of Kanauj, and he defeated the king of Bengal. Then Anartha of Gujarat, Malava of Madhya Pradesh, forest people, Turks, Vatsyamats, both kingdoms in the north. All this, like this, in favor, it was told more about this Nagbhatta. This we have seen here. Now, we can see that kings often were rewarded Brahmins. Okay, here we can see this inscriptions, or what I had told you, which is that document. So, kings often rewarded Brahmins by grants of land. Whenever these Brahmins used to write good things about these kings, or they used to help in the administration by writing all the things, kings used to reward these people, these Brahmanas, by giving the land. Okay, then king used to tell, from this area to this area, this land will be granted to you, and you can take any decisions, you can take whatever taxes, or you can collect these taxes and all things and have the rule over there. Then how this was recorded? This was recorded on these copper plates, which were given to those who received the land. So those who were getting this, see, you can see here small writings are there, and this is the seal, you can see, okay, of that king, and this can be called as royal seal, which indicates that it is authentic document, means not a false document, and this king's seal is given, and that is given by that king to that particular people, to those particular people. So again, land is given, means what was given in that land, here we have to see. Just now we have seen in that Prashastis how it was written, what things are given in it. This is a part of Tamil section of a land grant given by the Cholas. We have demarcated the boundaries of the land by making earthen embankments as well as planting thorny bushes. So to show that this particular area, they used to do earthen embankments, or they used to plant thorny bushes to show that particular area. In this, what the land contains? They used to contain fruit bearing trees, water land, gardens, orchard trees, wells, open spaces, pasture lands, village, ant hills, plant farms, canals, ditches, rivers, whatever, tanks, granaries, fish ponds, beehives. So whatever is there in the forest, all it would have. Again, see here, like unusual for the 12th century was a long Sanskrit poem containing the history of kings who ruled over Kashmir. Like this, you can see here, in 12th century, a long Sanskrit poem was written, and the history of kings who ruled over the Kashmir, and it was composed by an author, and that author's name was Kalhana. Like this means, those who used to write good poems or something about, they were given this type of lands. He used a variety of sources, including inscriptions, documents, eyewitness accounts, and early histories. So he gone through many, this Kalhana, this poet or this author, he went to through these documents, and I also he took some eyewitnesses accounts of the early histories to write this account. Unlike the writers of Prashastis, he often critical about rulers and their policies. In Prashastis, what you have seen, children, only there is the king tells whatever was good in favor of, and something more about that, means which may not be true, only some false things also might be told. But here, this critical about the rulers and their policies were told. Then we are going to see what is warfare for wealth. So it is just what we can tell, if the king is king and he is having some money or wealth and he is happy with that, it never happens, children. He wants to extend his boundaries, always he wants to attack on the other king or whoever is his enemies, or he wants to conquer all the things and expand his boundaries. He want to take all the wealth from other countries or other kings, and he wants to be the king of those people also of the other area. So warfare for wealth, why wars were there? For wealth. You may have noticed that each of these ruling dynasties was based in a specific region. So these dynasties were there in a particular area, in a particular region. At the same time, they tried to control that area, okay, only that particular area they were controlling. But here one particular prized area was of city Kannauj in the Ganga Valley. So which was that, why this people prized area, means this city of Kannauj in the Ganga Valley, why these people often wanted to go through, or they often wanted to conquer that area? Here we are going to see why these people, they often prize this area. For centuries, rulers belonging to Gurjara, Pratihara, Rashtrakuta, all these are dynasties, okay children, Gurjara, Pratihara, Rashtrakuta, Pala dynasties, all these are Kannauj, these are of a particular area. So because of, as there were three parties in this long drawn conflict, historians often describe them as a tripartite struggle. What is tripartite struggle? Means these three people, these three dynasties were often fighting in between themselves for this Ganga Valley, Kannauj city. So these were called tripartite struggle. Okay children, this, as it is a very lengthy part, again we will discuss in the new chapter what is tripartite. So today we have seen the emergence of new dynasties, how the administration of new kingdoms was there. Also we have seen Prashastis and land grants, what were the achievements of Nagabhatta. Also we have seen Prashastis, how it was sealed and all. Then warfare, today again we are going to continue with what are warfare for the wealth. Just as these new words are there, many of the new dynasties names you don't know, also they are somewhat difficult to understand, just go through the words again and again and it will be easy. We'll continue with the next topic, subtopics, in the next lecture.